Arizona Corporation Commission voted last week to cut incentives to developers of large solar projects in areas covered by APS and Tucson Electric Power. We'll hear from a member of the commission in a moment, but first, a rally opposing the changes was held this week in front of the commission's headquarters.
Commissioners Gary Pierce, Brenda Burns, Bob Stump, Susan Bittersmith, and Bob Burns all voted to eliminate key solar programs for customers of Arizona Public Service and Tucson Electric Power, two of Arizona's largest utility companies. Specifically, the ACC voted to cancel all commercial solar incentive programs and significantly reduce residential solar incentives. With this decision, the commission effectively pulled the rug out from underneath an otherwise promising industry. But it isn't just the solar industry that's hurt by a decision like this. It is now harder for businesses and homeowners to go solar in Arizona, the sunniest state in the country. What's more, it's our health and the growth of green jobs in Arizona that will also suffer. The fact is, Arizona should be the solar capital of the world. Arizonans know this. The governor knows this.
And joining me now to talk about the changes to the state's renewable energy programs is Commissioner Gary Pierce. Good to have you here. Thanks for joining us.
It's great to be here with you, Ted.
Performance-based solar incentives for commercial systems and for residential as well. Why the changes?
Well, we've been changing every year. Remember, we consider ourselves friends of solar. We keep these programs moving forward. And in Arizona, in fact, the production-based incentives or performance-based incentives, we're going to call those PBIs for the moment, we're way over our compliance heading towards 15% by 2025. And so because of that, and because we're at year 2019 as far as compliance, we think it's not fair to ratepayers to keep plunging ahead when we've been lowering them every year, and we simply did that again this year. But the natural point this year is to zero. The utility said we should have been zero last year, so this was not a surprise. The APS suggested it 6 months ago, so they all knew that the potential was there.
The idea, though, that with performance-based, especially for commercial, but with residential as well, even upfront commercial incentives as well, the incentives are there to eventually go away. What I hear from the industry is what you're doing now is cutting off at the knees. Instead of a soft landing, we're getting a hard landing.
Well, now, let's talk about it. We went to zero, but we were virtually there already at the end of the year. On residential, we started the year at 70 cents and moved all the way down. As production increased, we moved down to 10 cents per watt is our measure. And we were at $3 or $4 a watt when we started this 5 years ago. So you go to 10 cents a watt. So we started this year at 10 cents a watt. And that's where we're going to be throughout the year. But if we run out of money, we'll be to zero. But they're ready for that. And honestly, I looked at the video you just played. I don't know any of those people on the screen. They're not the solar folks that come and talk to us and work out these concepts that we need to move forward with.
But the solar folks that we've talked to, and I'm assuming some of the folks that you've talked to as well, they're saying that, again, they are making that increase. You're talking about improvements. Mm-hmm. They are making the improvements as well. They're 80%, I think 80% was the number there. Why not let it continue if it's going so well? Why, again, the abrupt change?
It was, and again, you say abrupt change. These are schedules on down. We look to be at 5 years in the discussion of the renewable energy plans from the start, that we were told we won't need anything after 5 years, and it really worked out that way. We kept residential up because we're not that much over compliance with residential, but we're already to the 2015 mark. So we're building more. And if you think about it, these were created when in 2006 the economy was booming, and then the economy took a dive, and we have flat growth right now. And for us to say we need more energy when we're not growing any kind of energy, whether that's nuclear or anything else, is a stretch. And so what's fair to ratepayers is to get them off of these incentives when they're ready to do it.
But the elimination, I'm going to tell you what they're telling me and what I'm hearing
Sure.
from them. The elimination of these performance-based solar incentives, they're saying that effectively kills commercial solar in Arizona. Are they wrong?
Yes, they're wrong. And there are installers who will tell you, and one emailed me, and we'll probably bring them all together. It said, I just got approval from Tucson Electric Power for a 500 kW project the day after the vote last week. And he said, by the way, I haven't offered incentives for 9 months. So they've been coming down. He said, I haven't needed them. And he says, I will double my business in 2013. So I think there's a lot to do about nothing here. And the proof will be in the pudding. It has been in the past. History, just last year, we had more power, virtually more power added to renewable energy power added more than the previous 4 years combined virtually. It's almost a wash. So it's working.
You have a success story there, but again, there may be other businesses out there, or perhaps not, but they're saying we could be losing jobs, we could be losing contracts because of the lack. This incentive, we need it for now. They're saying we don't want it in the future, but we need it now.
The businesses that maybe are going to let people go, those people will go to the ones who are. Their model shows that they can make it. I don't want to say that, you know, these folks are they're totally reliant on a government subsidy, and I hope they don't want to say that. But the reality is, it's time for that subsidy on the performance-based incentive to go away, because that's a legacy cost, and the legacy cost means those performance-based incentives, they're performance-based. You get them once a year for 20 years. Well, we've built up in APS's territory $735 million of legacy costs, which will go on. I mean, people will say, well, there's no more incentives. Did my bill go down? No. We have created, through these rules, which were created in 2006, we've created a monster of additional charges that will have to be paid over the next 20 years.
Is the monster tamed, though, when the solar industry is strong enough to where it not only doesn't need incentives, it can go past them?
Well, I think the reality is the commercial side needs to come forth and say, you know what, we will do it for 10 cents a watt, the same as residential. We don't need to, because see, they're getting more than residential. We'll do it for the same as residential and propose that plan if they're not at compliance. But they're so far over compliance right now. And I think that's an abuse of the ratepayers who have said, we want more renewable energy, and I agree with them, but it needs to be when we need that energy.
And you mentioned the ratepayers. I've heard the taxpayer savings for these kinds of eliminations and reductions is all of 2 to 6 cents a month. Is that accurate?
Oh, for maybe this year. But remember, those millions of dollars of legacy costs will actually kick the numbers up, because we're talking about this year adding it on, so it won't hit so much this budget year. It's future budget years.
The residential, the renewable energy standard, 15% 2025, did you try to lower that? Did you try to get an amendment passed to lower that?
Well, what I did is I had an amendment. I didn't actually make the motion for it, but I wanted everybody to see it, because actually I have a copy of amendment we ran in 2000 with the first implementation plan for the Morenci Water Company. I'm going to have to take a little bit
of
sip.
Right,
we're going like crazy here.
Go ahead.
Morenci Water and Power, which is primarily a former, at the time, a Phelps Dodge mine and a couple thousand residences, 15% wasn't going to work. Most of the energy was at the mine, 98% of the energy was at the mine, and so the cost of that surcharge to everybody was going to be astronomical. So Commissioner Mays actually ran an amendment to take away all that generation and do it based on the residential. So we actually are getting 15% based on 2% of the power over time. So it's nothing new, but I wanted people to understand we already aren't able to count Davis-Monthan. They have a lot of renewable energy, but the RECs did not go to TEP. Therefore, TEP can't count it as though at 15%. So we have a mismatch of concepts, and we really need the industry. And when I offered this amendment, I told the industry, I'm not going to make this motion today. I want you to think about it, and let's get our heads together and work together and develop a plan so we're not completely beaten up on ratepayers over this.
So your critics who say you tried to slip that in there, you're saying...
No, that's ridiculous.
Okay. Last question. You say you're a friend of solar. You say the commission is a friend of solar. With all of this going on, how do you convince folks you are? Because some would say, listen to all this and see all this and say, doesn't sound like a friend of solar.
Well, they have to look at our history. If they're just looking at today and say, oh, they cut solar. If you were listening a year ago, we cut solar. But we got more solar than really virtually any 3 years combined. And so they can say that, but the proof is not with them.
All right. It's good to have you here.
Thanks,
I'm glad
Ted.
You made it on the program. Good to have you.
All right.